Let's begin our worship service this morning by singing hymn number 128, I Sing the Mighty Power of God, number 128. Please remain standing as we sing all three verses. Number 128, I Sing the Mighty Power of God.
I sing the mighty power of God that made the mountains rise, that spread the flowing seas abroad and built the lofty skies. I sing the wisdom that ordained the sun to rule the day. The moon shines full at his command, and all the stars obey. I sing the goodness of the Lord that filled the earth with food. He formed the creatures with his word and pronounced them good. Lord, how thy wonders are displayed where'er I turn my eyes. If I survey the ground I tread, or gaze upon the sky, there's not a plant or flower below but makes thy glories known, and clouds arise and tempests blow by order from thy throne. While all that borrows life from thee is ever in thy care, and everywhere that man may be, thou God art present there.
Amen. Please be seated.
Our Old Testament reading today is found in Exodus chapter 14, so you're welcome to join me in your Bible. Exodus chapter 14, verses 19 through 31. Exodus 14. Then the angel of God, who was going before the host of Israel, moved and went behind them. And the pillar of cloud moved from before them and stood behind them, coming between the host of Egypt and the host of Israel. And there was the cloud and the darkness, and it lit up the night without one coming near the other all night. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord drove the sea back by a strong east wind all night and made the sea dry land, and the waters were divided. And the people of Israel went into the midst of the sea on dry ground, the waters being a wall to them on their right hand and on their left. The Egyptians pursued and went in after them into the midst of the sea, all Pharaoh's horses, his chariots, and his horsemen. And in the morning, watch, the Lord in the pillar of fire and of cloud looked down on the Egyptian forces and threw the Egyptian forces into a panic, clogging their chariot wheels so that they drove heavily. And the Egyptians said, "Let us flee from before Israel, for the Lord fights for them against the Egyptians." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the sea, that the water may come back upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots and upon their horsemen." So Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the sea returned to its normal course when the morning appeared. And as the Egyptians fled into it, the Lord threw the Egyptians into the midst of the sea. The waters returned and covered the chariots and the horsemen. Of all the host of Pharaoh that had followed them into the sea, not one of them remained. But the people of Israel walked on dry ground through the sea, the waters being a wall to them on their right hand and on their left. Thus the Lord saved Israel that day from the hand of the Egyptians. And Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the seashore. Israel saw the great power of the Lord used against the Egyptians. So the people feared the Lord, and they believed in the Lord and in his servant Moses. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
If you get your hymnals and stand as we sing, we'll sing number 122, Glorious is Thy Name, number 122. Please stand as we sing all four verses, number 122.
Blessed Savior, we adore Thee, we Thy love and grace proclaim. Thou art mighty, Thou art holy, glorious is Thy matchless name. Glorious, glorious, glorious is Thy name. Just an endless praise. Glorious, glorious, glorious is Thy name, O Lord. Glorious, glorious, glorious is Thy name, O of sin and shame. Thou didst come to die a ransom, guilty sinners to reclaim. Glorious, glorious, glorious is Thy name, O Lord. Glorious, glorious, is Thy name, O Lord. Come, O come, immortal Savior, and take Thy royal throne. Come and reign forever, be the kingdom all Thine own. Glorious, glorious, is Thy name, O Lord. Glorious, glorious, glorious is Thy name, O Lord.
Amen.
Let's pray. God, we're grateful for the opportunity to come into Your house today. And as the choir has opened up our service with How Majesty is Your Name, and as we have just sang now, Glorious is Your Name, our first order of prayer, Lord, is that we praise You. We praise You for who You are, what You have done, what You've created. We know without that we would be nothing. Lord, and we also ask You that You forgive our sins at this time. And when we do sin against You, Lord, that we're quick to confess those sins, and we know that You will forgive us for those as well. And Lord, we give You thanksgiving for what You've given us. We're about to take up an offertory. We pray that the offers and tithes that are given during this time will be used to honor You and glorify Your kingdom around the world, in this state, and in our community, and in this church. Lord, we, again, thank you for all the blessings of life that you give us. These things we pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Please be seated.
If you have a Bible, would you take your Bible and turn in your Bible to the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 18. Matthew 18, verses 21 through 35. Matthew 18, 21 through 35. And when you've found your place there, in sacred scripture, I invite you to follow along as I read it aloud. Together now, let's all give attention to the life-changing word of God. Then Peter came up and said to Jesus, "Lord, how often will my brother sin against me and I forgive him? As many as seven times?" Jesus said to him, "I do not say to you seven times, but 77 times. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his servants. When he began to settle, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. And since he could not pay, his master ordered him to be sold, with his wife and children and all that he had, and payment to be made. So the servant fell on his knees, imploring him, 'Have patience with me, and I will pay you everything.' And out of pity for him, the master of that servant released him and forgave him the debt. But when that same servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii, and seizing him, he began to choke him, saying, 'Pay what you owe.' So his fellow servant fell down and pleaded with him, 'Have patience with me, and I will pay you.' He refused and went and put him in prison until he should pay the debt. When his fellow servants saw what had taken place, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their master all that had taken place. Then his master summoned him and said to him, 'You wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. And should not you have had mercy on your fellow servant as I had mercy on you?' And in anger, his master delivered him to the jailers until he should pay all his debt. So also my heavenly Father will do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother from your heart." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Last year, up in Dakota County, Minnesota, a sheriff's officer arrested a man for an outstanding warrant. The man then tried to get out of jail. I didn't say he tried to escape. I said he tried to get out of jail. While being questioned, the man took a get out of jail free card from the Monopoly board game out of his wallet and handed it to the officer. The officer, of course, did not accept the card, but he did the next best thing and posted the story to the sheriff's officer's Facebook page. We believers carry two get-out-of-jail-free cards with us at all times. One of them was given to us. God gave us a get-out-of-jail-free card when he forgave us the debt of sin and rebellion we owed him. The second such card is ours to give away. Having been forgiven our great debt of wrongdoing against God, God wants us to forgive others their debt against us. Sometimes the very last thing we want to do is forgive. We want our pound of flesh. We want to collect our debt in full. We want our rights. But God doesn't forgive us so that we may then withhold forgiveness from others. According to our text for this morning, Matthew chapter 18, verses 21 through 35, God generously forgives, so we must generously forgive others. This is Jesus' fourth extended talk in Matthew's gospel. The subject is life within the church. He's been talking about how to address sin, which sets the stage quite nicely for this next question. Verse 21 of chapter 18 says, "Then Peter came up and said to him, 'Lord, how often will my brother sin against me and I forgive him?'" In other words, "Lord Jesus, how many times must I forgive a fellow believer who sins against me?" "As many as seven times," Peter suggests. Peter thinks he's being generous by suggesting a sevenfold forgiveness. Jesus, though, continues to surprise his disciples. In verse 22, he replies, "I do not say to you seven times, but 77 times." Obviously, 77 is greater than seven, meaning that Jesus expects Peter to be much more forgiving than he initially offers. But Jesus doesn't literally mean 77. As the great difference between 7 and 77 suggests, Jesus intends for Peter to be lavish, limitless, over-generous in his forgiveness. "Therefore," says Jesus in verse 23, "the kingdom of heaven may be compared to..." Stop right there. Jesus is starting to tell a parable. A parable, remember, is a short story that teaches a lesson. Jesus, as Matthew's gospel indicates, likes teaching in parables. So here he goes again, telling another parable to illustrate the point he just made to Peter about forgiveness. "Therefore," says Jesus, "the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his servants. For reasons not germane and therefore left unexplained by Jesus, the servants of a certain king owe the king a debt of money. In particular," says Jesus in verse 24, "one such servant was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents." 10,000 talents, as Jesus' original hearers know, is a ridiculous amount of money. There is no way in real life a servant would owe a king 10,000 talents. There is no way that he would incur a debt like that. A mere 2 talents is what a laborer might hope to earn in his entire lifetime. So what is Jesus saying? What does he mean when he says that the servant owes an almost unimaginable 10,000 talents? Well, like with the number 77, he means a limitless amount. The servant owes the king a debt so stratospheric, there is no conceivable way he can pay it off. Verse 25 confirms that the servant can't pay the debt. Accordingly, quote, "his master ordered him to be sold, with his wife and children and all that he had, and payment to be made. Not only the servant himself, but his family and his belongings likewise belong to his master. The master then prepares to sell them all to another master to make up at least some of the servant's debt." In verse 26, the servant, quote, "fell on his knees, pleading with his master for patience." He says he'll pay, quote, "everything," which is both awkward and unusual and untruthful, since Jesus has already stated that he can't pay. Like most anyone would do, he's simply exhausting all options in order to avoid judgment. Well, the master, says verse 27, takes pity on the servant. Explicitly out of compassion, not calculation or convenience. Quote, the master of that servant released him and forgave him the debt. He didn't give him an extension to pay it off. He didn't lessen the amount owed. He wiped the entire debt away. 10,000 talents, literally 5,000 lifetimes worth of labor, which is to say a virtually infinite debt, forgiven. What the master does is lavish, limitless, overgenerous. What a feel-good story this is. If only it was finished. Alas, in verse 28, this newly, radically forgiven servant goes out and finds a fellow servant who's indebted to him. The amount owed, says Jesus, is 100 denarii. 100 denarii is 3 or 4 months' wages. Compared to 10,000 talents, 100 denarii is, as they say, chump change. Yet over this drastically smaller debt, the first servant attacks the second servant, choking him and demanding, pay what you owe. Almost verbatim, verse 29 says that the second servant pleads with the first servant, like the first servant pleaded with the king earlier. This is intentional on Jesus' part. He's reminding his hearers that this is when the king had compassion and forgave the first servant his incredible debt. But the first servant doesn't do like the king. Instead of compassionate, he's callous. Verse 30 says that he refuses the second servant's plea. While he can't sell him off like the king threatened to do to him, he can have him thrown in prison, which he does, quote, until he should pay the debt. Verse 31 says that his fellow servants witnessed all this and, quote, were greatly disturbed. They can't believe the first servant's cruelty, especially given that he has recently received mercy in a similar matter. Their concern compels them to go and tell the matter to their master, the king. The king, in verse 32, then summons the first servant. First, he scolds him. You wicked servant! He reminds him of the forgiveness he gave him for an even greater offense. I forgave all your debt because you pleaded with me. And then, in verse 33, he states what the first servant should have done. And should not you have had mercy on your fellow servant as I had mercy on you? And in anger, says verse 34, his master delivered him to the jailers until he should pay all his debt. Irate that the first servant failed to give as he had received, the king withdraws his forgiveness. Since the first servant never really appreciated the king's forgiveness, he's still on the hook for the 10,000 talents he owes. Ironically, the first servant lands right alongside the second servant in jail. On this tragic note, the parable ends. In verse 35, Jesus sums up the lesson in a single statement. So also, my heavenly Father will do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother from your heart. In other words, God doesn't forgive the unforgiving. His generosity, as the king shows, is beyond measure, but it's good only for those who will themselves be forgiving. For God to apply it, they must truly appreciate it, not presume upon it and take advantage of it. Peter, remember, asked Jesus how many times he must forgive a fellow believer who sins against him? Jesus replied that Peter must be lavish, limitless, overgenerous in his forgiveness. The parable then explains why. It's because God, the King of the kingdom, the master of the house, has forgiven his servants the same way, lavishly, limitlessly, overgenerously. Moreover, God has forgiven a greater debt than Peter will ever deal with. In the context of Jesus' mission as Messiah, God's anointed deliverer, 10,000 talents represents the incredible debt of rebellion that God forgives believers. Having been forgiven his own great debt, Peter should be willing to forgive all other relatively trifling offenses represented by the 100 denarii against himself. Today's text, remember, takes place as part of Jesus' fourth major discourse, focusing on life within the disciple community, the church. Now, that being so, ultimately, this isn't a lesson for Peter alone, but for the entire church. God forgives, and he does so, amazingly so, down to the uttermost depths of humanity's sin debt. Believers, therefore, having received forgiveness, have no right at all to withhold it from each other. Those freely forgiven must in turn themselves be freely forgiving. My wife Michaela, back when she was a seminary student in Birmingham, was classmates with an older woman named Carolyn McKinstry. Carolyn McKinstry has a special story of forgiveness, so special that it was published back in 2011. The title of her book is While the World Watched. Carolyn grew up in Birmingham. She attended church in Birmingham. One Sunday morning, 15-year-old Carolyn, while walking from Sunday school to the sanctuary, stopped at the girls' restroom door to talk briefly with some friends, four friends to be exact. As she left them, Carolyn heard the phone ring in the church office. She answered the call, only to hear a male voice ominously say, 3 minutes. Puzzled, Carolyn left the office and went upstairs. Not a minute later, just as Carolyn entered the sanctuary, the church shook as a bomb bearing no fewer than 15 sticks of dynamite blasted through the east side, right next to the girls' restroom where Carolyn had just been and where she had just said, "See you later," to her four friends. Those four little girls, as they would later be memorialized, were killed that instant. Had she lingered down there any longer, Carolyn herself would have become the fifth little girl. The KKK bombing of 16th Street Baptist Church on September 15, 1963, traumatized Carolyn. As one article says, in the years that followed, Carolyn fell into depression, despair, alcoholism, and bitterness. She attended college, got married, and had three children, but the bombing destroyed her spirit. For decades after, the murderous Klansman who planted the bomb and killed her friends walked about freely. Terror, fear, and hatred haunted her soul. As Carolyn herself says, "The deaths of my four girlfriends left me with a pain I cannot describe." Carolyn wrestled with God over her pain for a long time. At one point, in a fit of frustration, she wrote God a letter. She says he replied, urging her to forgive the killers. The exchange marked a turning point in Carolyn's life, and none too soon. In 2002, she was summoned to testify at the trial of one of the 16th Street bombers, forcing her to face someone who owed her what any reasonable person would call an incredible debt of loss and pain and grief. Carolyn was ready, not just to testify, but also to forgive. She writes, "Jesus forgave the men who crucified him, as well as the thief who hung beside him. Pondering that scripture, I came to understand that I needed to forgive those who had hurt me and my family and friends. And that forgiveness was more important for me than for them. It allowed me to move forward with the life God had planned for me. I know that because of the way Christ has forgiven me, I have no option but to forgive those who intentionally hurt me and those I love." That last statement by Carolyn sums up today's application. How shall we live in light of so lavish, limitless, and overgenerous a forgiveness that God has given us? I have no option but to forgive others. So says a victim of a heinous, murderous, civil rights era church bombing. This is how we prove that we truly appreciate God's forgiveness. We forgive others their trespasses against us. A community of the forgiven naturally and necessarily forgives. Inevitably, we all get hurt, injured in spirit, if not also body or some other material way. It's how life works in this fallen, sin-sick, rebellious world. I'm confident, therefore, that I am speaking to those who would say you've been wronged and that now you are owed a debt for your pain and anguish. No doubt we've all got ledgers full of outstanding debt that a lot of folks owe us. Maybe the debt is the result of a mere personal slight. Maybe the debt is tremendous and tremendously painful, the result of a life-changing trauma. Maybe it's somewhere between. I want us to put two images side by side in our minds for a moment. Put God's ledger next to your own ledger of debt. Now, according to Jesus in today's text, God's ledger is blank, owing to the fact that our debt of sin has been wiped away. But for some, if not many of us, the same isn't true of our own ledger, right? It's written up and down and all in the margins with slights and insults and offenses and even crimes that folks have committed against us. And so long as that debt remains outstanding, we resent them. Maybe we even hate them for it. Jesus says to forgive, and generously so. 77 times, he says. It's like a closeout sale. All grudges must go, all hate erased, all debts disposed of. Remember how Jesus teaches us to pray back in Matthew chapter 6? "And forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors." As Christians, as little Christs, we forgive. It comes with the calling to follow Jesus. It's our way of life. Some debts exist due to hurtful things that have been said. Maybe your spouse said something ugly during a recent dust up. Maybe your neighbor yelled at you for making a racket. Maybe your coworker was critical of your work. Maybe a fellow church member got cross with you during a committee meeting. On the one hand, they owe you a debt, at least an apology. On the other hand, as believers, you owe them forgiveness. Did they do anything to deserve your forgiveness? No, but neither did you do anything to deserve God's forgiveness. So forgive them already. Some debts exist due to material harm. I have not yet forgotten the feeling from 5 years ago of learning that my house back in Birmingham had been burglarized one morning. And I was angry at the person who took my TV, whoever they were. Has anything like that happened to you? And maybe you found out who it was. At any rate, they are indebted to you on account of doing you wrong like that. But see, you've been forgiven an even greater offense by God. God didn't stay mad at you when you turned your back on him. So you forgive the person who stole whatever they stole from you. Some debts, sadly, exist due to physical harm. We live in a messed up world in which fathers hit their children, the husbands strike their wives, and bullies beat up on their helpless peers, and drunk drivers run into innocent motorists, and yes, racists bomb churches. I do not mean to be dismissive when I say that we must forgive these debts too. I've already cited the story of Carolyn McKinstry, who took years, long time to work through her pain in order to forgive. I'm also thinking of my preaching professor, who forgave the man who murdered his son during a robbery at a fast food restaurant. But I'm also thinking of Jesus, hanging on that cross, who said this about his executioners: Father, forgive them. It's these moments of forgiveness between victim and assailant that especially reveal and validate and magnify the depth of forgiveness that God has bestowed upon us believers. Now, to be clear, forgiving someone doesn't excuse them from facing justice regardless of their wrongdoing. Some wrongs absolutely must be held accountable by society's justice system. Remember, forgiving means foregoing your personal desire for personal payback. It means wishing to see the one who hurt you repent and reform, which the justice system can help make happen. Those who cannot forgive others need to ask themselves if they've really received God's forgiveness. God applies it to those who will appreciate it, and those who appreciate it are those who will practice it. Do you truly appreciate that God has canceled your great debt of sin that otherwise dooms you to hell? Then go and prove it. Forgive others their offenses against you in the same spirit, the lavish, limitless, overgenerous spirit by which you have been forgiven. You know, for some sermons, it takes more effort on my part to point out the presence of the gospel. Some sermons. This sermon isn't one of them. The gospel, the good news, is obvious, right? Why do we forgive? Because God has forgiven us. at a lavish, limitless, overgenerous rate. Why do we forgive? Because failing to forgive isn't in us anymore. Not since we found our Savior and started following our Lord. Jesus died on the cross to bestow God's forgiveness to the whole world. And without His shed blood, we are all still condemned for all our sinfulness. But Jesus has satisfied that death sentence. He took our place. And now, instead of giving us judgment, God now gives us forgiveness. His forgiveness comes with a new spirit. The Holy Spirit, who changes us from the inside out, so that now we are willing to forgive others like we ourselves have been forgiven. This good news here is the basis of Jesus' pronouncement. Forgive, and forgive freely. Forgive radically. Forgive like God. The gospel, remember, isn't just about the past, but the future too. See, there's a good supply of gospel motivation for today's application when we look ahead too. To that great going up to heaven day. And that great kingdom coming day. God's forgiveness isn't finished with us till we enter the eternal place He has prepared for us. With a future like that, how can we not obey what God commands in the present? God generously forgives. So, we must generously forgive others. Let's pray together. Lord, You did not say this would be easy, but obviously this is right. Help us, God, to forgive. Help us to forgive the things that we shouldn't even have taken offense over to begin with. Help us, Lord, to deal with perhaps years and mountains of pain in order to forgive. We here, Lord, we are a community of the forgiven. Help us, in turn, to be forgiving. For therein we will become a true church, a church after Your own heart. We pray this in Your name, Father, Son, and Spirit. One God, now and forever. Amen. This is the time of the worship service where we take up a hymn of response and invitation. The hymn itself is it's a vehicle, right? It's a means.